MedCram.com.
Welcome to another MedCram COVID-19 update. Wanted to talk a little bit about the CDC data. We've been getting a lot of requests to comment regarding the weekly updates by select demographic and geographic characteristics. And specifically, this is the data that shows that apparently 6% of the patients who died that had COVID-19 written somewhere on their death certificate had only COVID-19 written on their death certificate. So 6% of those only had COVID-19 written on their death certificate. And there's been some questions about that. And what's raised so much attention is this section called Comorbidities. And says here, Table 3 shows the types of health conditions and contributing causes mentioned in conjunction with deaths involving COVID-19. It goes on to say that for 6% of deaths, COVID-19 was the only cause mentioned. Now, I think some have gone on to say that the true deaths from COVID-19 are only 6% of what we thought they were. And what I want to show you is exactly where they're coming from and what does this mean. So I want you to imagine that somebody comes into the hospital. This gentleman here, hypothetically, has diabetes type 2. And unfortunately, he gets a cut on his hand and some bacteria that lives on his skin called Streptococcus pyogenes or some other Streptococcus or even staph gets involved and it causes a skin infection, a cellulitis. But because he's immunocompromised because of his diabetes, he develops a very bad case of what we call necrotizing fasciitis. Essentially, what this is flesh-eating bacteria. He has to go into the hospital to get surgery, but unfortunately, despite antibiotics and full-dose medications and attention, develops septic shock. He develops renal failure. And finally, unfortunately, goes into cardiac arrest, and he dies. So let's look at a death certificate potentially. And you can see here, this death certificate is actually from the state of Hawaii, but it's pretty similar to the one that we use in California, and I'm sure not too different than the other 48 states. So the key here is you need to put down the immediate cause, the final disease or condition resulting in death. That's the most proximal cause here to death. And then they say here to sequentially list conditions, if any, leading to the cause listed on line A. Enter the underlying cause, the disease or injury that initiated the events resulting in death last. Now, it's interesting because I got this example from the state of Hawaii as for the guidance for certifying COVID-19 deaths. Let's talk about that in a little bit. But if we go back to our example of this type 2 diabetic who developed necrotizing fasciitis, came into the hospital, had septic shock, renal failure, and then cardiac arrest, the most proximal thing that caused death was the cardiac arrest. Although most cases, cardiac arrest would be the most proximal cause, but reporting agencies like us to use more descriptive terms in terms of what our patients die from. The heart is always going to stop. And that's going to tell you when death occurs, except in rare circumstances. But here, clearly, one of the things towards the top of this would be necrotizing fasciitis. And then you might be able to say that maybe type 2 diabetes was an underlying contributing factor, because we know that type 2 diabetics are more immunocompromised. But the key point here is that if you were to ask somebody, hey, Mr. Smith, what did he die of? Well, did he die of type 2 diabetes? No, he didn't really die of type 2 diabetes. It's not like he was going to die of type 2 diabetes anyway. This was something that was a major turning point. He was a controlled type 2 diabetic, and all of a sudden he developed necrotizing fasciitis. So that's something that's really important. But clearly, it's not like septic shock just coincidentally appeared. No, it was caused by the necrotizing fasciitis. Same thing with the renal failure. The renal failure was caused by the necrotizing fasciitis. And the cardiac arrest ultimately was caused by these other things, but they all go back to this inciting factor of the necrotizing fasciitis. So let's go and take a look at the COVID-19 stuff. And clearly here you can see that people who die of COVID-19, as far as I know, and I've taken care of many patients with COVID-19, all of them who died had abnormal chest x-rays and therefore could be said have pneumonia. Even asymptomatic people with COVID can have abnormal chest x-rays. And then, of course, if it gets so bad that they die, they go into cardiac arrest, or they have acute respiratory distress syndrome, or ARDS. They go into respiratory failure. Now, it's not as though this pneumonia just sort of happened coincidentally in COVID-19 patients. No, in fact, this is just like the septic shock or the renal failure with the necrotizing fasciitis. COVID-19 causes pneumonia. Don't miss that. COVID-19 causes acute respiratory distress syndrome. These are comorbidities in the sense that, yes, they're there happening at the same time. But make no mistake, they are not usually there coincidentally. They're there because they were caused by COVID-19. And so you can see here clearly that if you follow the recommendations of these state reporting authorities, that really COVID-19 should never really be at the top line. Because COVID-19 kills through doing things. You can go back and look at our videos, how coronavirus kills. And for the most part, it's people who go into ARDS or acute respiratory distress syndrome. Now, of course, there's other exceptions to that. People can get strokes. People can go into just fulminant cardiac arrest. Certainly that happens. And we know that they can get blood clots, pulmonary embolism. So certainly that can happen as well. But COVID-19 should really not be on the top line here. And how do we know this? We know this because people come in that are not really that sick, and they go to the regular floor. And as they get worse in terms of their oxygenation, we start to see that they go into ARDS. The ARDS happens after the COVID-19 positive test. So if we go back to the CDC website, and of course, we'll put a link in the description below, we can see what these other conditions contributing to deaths involving coronavirus disease are. Let's take a look at these. Influenza and pneumonia. That's a comorbidity in the sense, but it can be caused. Pneumonia could be caused by coronavirus. Here's chronic lower respiratory diseases. Obviously, these are going to be there before coronavirus. So that makes sense. Adult respiratory distress syndrome. Here we go again. Actually, the term here is acute respiratory distress syndrome. They've actually used the wrong term here on the CDC website. But acute respiratory distress syndrome is caused by COVID-19. Respiratory failure and respiratory arrest is caused by COVID-19. So they always should be there together. What about circulatory diseases? Certainly hypertensive diseases can be there before coronavirus. Ischemic heart disease can be there before coronavirus. Cardiac arrest, unfortunately, something that is caused by the coronavirus. Cardiac arrhythmia, the same thing. Heart failure, the same thing. Cerebrovascular diseases like stroke, same thing. Sepsis, same thing. These all can be caused by COVID-19. Obviously, malignant neoplasms are not caused by COVID-19. They're a comorbidity. Diabetes is a comorbidity. Obesity, obviously, is a comorbidity. And the list goes on and on and on. So the bottom line is, if you look at this, the fact that 6% of the deaths, COVID-19 was the only cause mentioned, please explain to me how COVID-19 kills somebody without causing a pneumonia, without causing a cardiac arrest, without causing a stroke. Please tell me how that happens. What does it look like when someone dies of only COVID-19? The reason why I ask is because the bottom line for why 6% of the deaths COVID-19 was the only cause mentioned, in my humble opinion, is that the death certificate was filled out incorrectly. They should have put a more proximal cause, a cause proximal to death, something like pneumonia or cardiac arrest, because COVID-19 kills because of organs that shut down and no longer work. That's practically how all infectious diseases kill. They cause an overwhelming infection, which causes multi-organ dysfunction and either cardiac arrest, respiratory arrest, or some other devastating injury. So despite that understanding, some people have put forth the notion that the 6% figure is the true COVID death rate because all the other things were comorbidities that people were going to die of anyway. So if that were the case, and you were to look at total mortality for the United States, let's look at the first graph here. If in fact it was misclassified as a COVID death when it really shouldn't have been a COVID death, it was a death that was going to happen anyway. We know how many people die on average every year in the United States. And so what it should look like, this graph, is it really should look no different than any other year. So you'd have this small increase, and this would represent the 6% of all the COVID deaths where only COVID is listed on the death certificate. But what is the trend that we're actually seeing with the data? And remember, the data was looked at back in May by the Washington Post with an article titled "Excess U.S. Deaths Hit Estimated 37,000 in Pandemic's Early Days, Far More Than Previously Known." And here's the seasonal average as it starts to go down after the regular flu season. Notice this is 60,000, 50,000, 40,000. And you can see here that there's the reported COVID-19 deaths, but in fact, the death rate is actually higher. So there's an excessive death rate other than those reported for COVID-19. So it appears that these deaths would not have happened anyway. Here's data from the United Kingdom. Notice here on the y-axis that we start at zero and we go to 20,000. And so you can see here that the blue is the average deaths over the last 4 years. That's 2019 all the way back to 2015. And then for 2020, we can see here that the deaths almost doubled at a certain point there in the spring. So I don't think that these people were going to, quote, die anyway, unquote. So my thoughts on it are, if you want to know what the impact is of COVID-19 on the death rate in the United States, then look at the excess deaths. A lot of you also asked about this Bradykinin hypothesis of COVID-19. Now, apparently this computer analyzed a number of genes and highlighted the renin-angiotensin system, which we knew was involved because of SARS-CoV-2 hitting the ACE2 receptor, which is involved in the renin-angiotensin system. But we also know that bradykinin, which is a polypeptide, is also metabolized by the ACE enzyme, and that this may not just be a cytokine storm, but also a bradykinin storm as well, bradykinin being this molecule which can cause a lot of these issues and problems, including swelling, including fluid retention, etc. And as it says here in the article, in the kinin system, bradykinin, which is the key peptide, causes blood vessels to leak, allowing fluid to accumulate in organs and tissue. And in COVID-19 patients, this system was unbalanced, as we've talked about. People with the disease have increased gene expression for the bradykinin receptors and for enzymes known as kallikreins that activate the kinin pathway. And they published this paper, and we'll give you a link to it in the description below. And what they show in the article is a very complex system of interactions that may explain a lot of what we see in COVID-19. One of the points that was brought up in the article that I found very interesting was where it says here that vitamin D may potentially be useful because it's involved in the renin-angiotensin system and may reduce levels of REN, another compound involved in the system. And of course, you know that we've been talking about vitamin D for some period of time now. And speaking about vitamin D, there's a very interesting article that was published, and I'll give you the reference to this article, that looked at 76 consecutive patients that were randomized to aggressive vitamin D analog supplementation versus placebo. As it says here, this was a parallel pilot randomized open label double masked clinical trial. And this was done fairly early on because at the time the standard of care was a combination of hydroxychloroquine and azithromycin. But these patients were allocated in a 2-to-1 ratio for calcifediol to no calcifediol. Now, calcifediol is a vitamin D analog that actually gets better absorption and is more potent. It's used often by nephrologists for patients with parathyroid issues. And in this case, the patients received a pretty hefty dose at 532 micrograms on the first day, and then a repeat of 266 micrograms on days 3 and 7. Now, in this case, 50 patients were treated with calcifediol and 26 were not treated. So to show you in terms of a flow sheet, what happened, they took 76 patients, 50 of them were randomized to calcifediol, and 26 no calcifediol. Of those 50, 2% were admitted to the intensive care unit, and overall, 0% of them died, and all of them were discharged. Whereas those that did not receive it, 50% of them went to the ICU, and 7.7% of them ended up dead. And in terms of the differences between these two, they looked at univariate analysis and multivariate analysis, and there was statistical significance. So the conclusion of the authors were that calcifediol seems to be able to reduce severity of the disease, but larger trials with groups properly matched will be required to show a definitive answer. And what they're referring to there is that the number of patients in each group was small enough that there wasn't a perfect match in terms of the differences in populations. They do say here that the randomization generated groups with comparable percentage of unfavorable risk factors, as there was no significant difference in subjects with at least one risk factor, except for high blood pressure and diabetes mellitus, known risk factors for unfavorable disease progression, which were more frequent in patients not treated in calcifediol. However, even considering these factors, calcifediol significantly decreased the need for ICU admission in COVID-19 patients in a way not previously reported. They also go on to talk about calcifediol, which is a prescription medication, versus just vitamin D itself. Notice what they say here. Furthermore, to correct vitamin D deficiency in severely sick patients, much higher doses of vitamin D than usual are needed. Our study does not include a comparison with cocalciferol, the native vitamin D3 form and nutritional substrate for calcifediol. So we cannot conclude that calcifediol is superior to vitamin D itself. Nevertheless, calcifediol may have some advantages over native vitamin D. It has a more reliable intestinal absorption and can rapidly restore serum concentrations of 25-hydroxyvitamin D, as it does not require hepatic 25-hydroxylation. So I thought this was an interesting article because we've been giving our patients in the hospital daily supplementation of vitamin D. And if you want to learn more about vitamin D, I suggest that you look at our update 97. Also look at one of the very first videos that we did on this way back 5-6 months ago in update 30. And check out what I use in terms of supplementation in update 59. Also, don't forget to check out medcram.com. We cover topics like EKG, how to read a chest x-ray, how to interpret a CBC, and coming soon, how to interpret a basic metabolic panel. Thanks for joining us.